some years ago, it was about 2 weeks before my mother's birthday, and I called her up and I said to her, would you like to come with me on your birthday and meet someone? And she said, no, I can't, I'm afraid. I'm going to one of my sisters for my birthday. So sorry, I can't come. I said, okay, well, never mind. There was a pause, and she said, well, who could I meet? Who are you going to meet? I said, well, it was the Queen, actually. Mm-hmm. There was another pause, and my mother said, well, I'm sure Sarah wouldn't mind if I didn't come. So my mother got to meet the Queen on her birthday, which was good for her. And she was pleased that I could arrange this to happen. Well, what I'd like to do this morning is I'd like to introduce you to Jesus and to look at the way in which he met this woman at the well. And we didn't have time to read it, but in the previous chapter, in chapter 3, there's another meeting of Jesus. In fact, the Gospel of John was one of Jesus's 12 disciples. He was an eyewitness to what Jesus did, and he wrote his Gospel some years after Jesus died and was resurrected. John 3, the previous chapter, is about Jesus meeting a man called Nicodemus. So John puts these two stories together, Jesus meeting Nicodemus, Jesus meeting this woman. We don't know her name. We do know Nicodemus's name. And in many ways, the two meetings of Jesus, they're with two very, very, very different peoples, because Nicodemus is a very religious person. He's a Jew. He's a man, obviously. And he's very confident in his own grasp of religion. So he comes as a rabbi, like a priest, if you like, a very, very holy man. And the woman at the well is the exact opposite in many ways. So she's a woman, and in those days women had a low status. She's also not Jewish, she's a Samaritan. I'll explain to you in a minute who the Samaritans were, but they were despised and looked down on by the Jews. She was also a very, as we're going to see in a minute, she was a very unreligious person. In fact, she had some ideas, but they were completely wrong and confused. She came, by the way, in the middle of the day at 12 noon, and this is in what's now Israel, so it would have been very hot. Nicodemus came by night. Nicodemus came looking for Jesus. The Samaritan woman came looking to get some water, and she met Jesus, who was sitting, if you like, on the side of the well, and met her there. So in many ways, they were opposites, but they had something very important in common. They were both hungry and thirsty, not so much for water and food, but for God himself, but they didn't know it. And their greatest need was that both of them were sinners. Both of them had done many wrong things. Now, the strange thing is that this Samaritan lady instinctively knew that she was a sinner, whereas Nicodemus was full of confidence, thought, I'm basically okay with God, and I'll do Jesus a favor by turning up and talking to him. Because this question of who is a sinner and how do we get right with God is a very, very important question. You see, Nicodemus thought he was okay with God because he was a man, he was a rabbi, he was a Jew, he was very respected. The woman didn't. She, as we will see in a minute, she sort of knew that she was an outsider and that she had violated God's rules. Neither of them could understand, if you like, their spiritual, their inward need. The woman thought she needed water, that's why she'd come. Obviously there were no taps in those days, so you'd carry a big water pot. You couldn't go to the sink, you'd go to the well, and you'd fill it up and you'd take it back. So she thought she needed a drink, but actually she had a spiritual and inward and eternal need that Jesus was going to address. And what's interesting, friends, is that Nicodemus, if you like, goes down as Jesus deals with him, and he deals with him in quite a tough way. Nicodemus gets more and more confused, and Nicodemus's part of the conversation gets shorter and shorter. Whereas the Samaritan woman, she in the end understands Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is God's promised one who's coming. Now, we can thank God that eventually Nicodemus, even though he was blinded, if you like, by his conventional religiosity, and he thought he was okay, in the end he realized, no, everybody needs a savior. Everybody needs a forgiveness. Everybody needs to believe in the Messiah. And the reason we know that is that when Jesus was on the cross, Nicodemus, along with another man called Joseph of Arimathea, went to Pilate. And this was a very courageous thing to do, because they went to Pilate and said, please give us Jesus's body, which they then put in the tomb. And hopefully you know what happened there. 3 days later, after Jesus died, the stone was rolled away and Jesus came back from the dead. Hallelujah. But Nicodemus was then used by God in that. But at this time in John chapter 3, he didn't get it. And the Samaritan woman, friends, comes and meets Jesus and realizes, like a light bulb being turned on, who Jesus is. Mm. Now, just a few words then on who the Samaritans were. If you imagine a map of Israel, you have in the north, you have Galilee, that was mainly Jews with some Greeks. In the south of Israel, there's Jerusalem, which was the center 2,000 years ago of the Jewish faith. But in the middle, the Midlands, we would say, the kind of Birmingham, if you like, nothing against Birmingham, between the north and the south were the Samaritans. And if you look at your Bibles, you see chapter 4, verse 4, he, that's Jesus, must needs go through Samaria. He must needs go through Samaria. That's an interesting word, isn't it? It was necessary that he went through Samaria. Why? Well, in one sense, you could say it was geographically necessary, because to go from here to here, could either go on a boat, but if you wanted to walk, that was the obvious way to go. But I don't think that's what the verse means. It means it was necessary because God himself, in human form, wanted to meet with this woman. And do you know something? God himself, through his word, which tells us about Jesus, wants to meet with each one of you today. And in the same way as that Samaritan woman met with Jesus at the well and had a surprise. She had a great surprise. So I hope that the same thing will happen to you, and that you will meet the risen Lord Jesus. Now these Samaritans, they were hated and they were despised by the Jews. You see, about 700 years before Jesus was meeting with this woman, the Assyrians, who were the kind of big imperial power of the day, they had deported most of the Jews from the northern tribes off to Assyria. And what the Assyrians did was they would basically mix everybody up. So they would bring all sorts of people into Samaria and mix them up, and then they would take a lot of the people, but not all of them, and put them all over the place, goodness knows where. So the Samaritans were very mixed up and confused. They only believed in the first five books of the Bible. That's what's called the Torah, the Pentateuch. That's Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. They didn't have the rest. They didn't use at all the other five books. And the Jews looked down on them. They thought they were heretics. They thought they were wrong, and they were wrong. And Jesus actually says, you've got it wrong. But he does it in such a kind and loving way. And they were expecting, though, some kind of Messiah-type figure. And they called this person the prophet. And some of their ideas were good, but they were very confused and mixed up. So Jesus, it was necessary for Jesus to go to Samaria. It was necessary for him to meet this woman. And it's necessary for him, friends, to meet you, isn't it? Isn't that good? It's good to come to church. When we come to church, it's not particularly a holy place, is it? It's just a room, but we can meet there the risen Lord Jesus. Mm. Now, what was Jesus doing there? Verse 6. Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well. It was about the sixth hour. There comes a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus says to her, give me to drink. Okay, so we know two things about Jesus. Jesus is 100% God. He's also 100% human. Because here, he's tired, he has to sit down, and he's thirsty, he needs a drink. Now, in the early church, there were people who taught, which was wrong, that Jesus wasn't really fully human. He was God, but he didn't really have a full humanity. Nowadays, we tend to have the other way around, don't we? We have people who say that Jesus was fully human. If you go out and talk to people in the area, they may tell you, oh yeah, Jesus was a great man. He had a kind of divine spirit, but he wasn't God. But in the first 300 years of the church, it was more the other way around. It was more that people thought, Jesus can't be both God and human. So they used to teach that Jesus wasn't really... Good morning. Welcome. That Jesus wasn't... Good morning. Welcome. We're looking at Jesus meeting a Samaritan woman. Congratulations on winning the title, by the way. So what happens here is that we see that Jesus is both fully God and he's fully human. And Jesus, who is God, comes down and he's so kind and gentle with this lady, because she keeps kind of zooming off the subject, she keeps trying to change the subject. And Jesus, very kindly and graciously, very different to the way he deals with Nicodemus, keeps drawing her back to basically the question, which is, who am I? Who is Jesus? And you know, the amazing thing is that with God's help, this lady grows in her understanding about God. Look at the passage. So she starts off quite rudely in verse 9. She says, well, how is it? You're a Jew. Okay? So it's like, you're one of the enemy. And then by verse 11, she says, sir. That's a term of respect. Okay? She's beginning to change. And then in verse 19, she says, not only sir again, she says, sir, I perceive you're a prophet. So she's growing in her understanding that this is not an ordinary person. This is somebody quite unusual who's there. And then finally, which is wonderful, friends, in verse 25, the light is beginning to go off, and she says, I know that the Messiah is coming, which is called Christ. Both Messiah is the Hebrew word, means anointed, God's chosen one. Christ means the same thing in Greek. And Jesus says to her, yeah, that's me. I am the Messiah. And what she does then in verse 29, and she runs off to the city and starts telling all her friends, is not this the Christ? Or actually, the better translation would be, this couldn't be the Christ, could it? So you see, over these 20 verses, her understanding of who Jesus is begins to grow. And friends, that's the same with us, hopefully, in a way. As we hear God's word and we listen to God and he speaks to us, we understand more and more who Jesus is. Now, it's interesting that the woman comes, verse 6, at about the sixth hour. Okay, so that's noon, about, where are we now? Yeah, 11:45, so it would have been like this. But unlike England, where it's somewhat chilly, even in May, at midday, in Israel, it would have been baking hot. It would have probably been 35, 40 degrees. We obviously don't know the exact weather, but it would have been hot. And it was a very strange time to come and get water. It was the one time of the day when nobody would come. Do you remember the old song, Mad Dogs and Englishmen Go Out in the Midday Sun? If you live in a hot climate, you do not go out from about 12 to 3 because it's so hot. And women certainly didn't go and get water at that time of day. So what was this woman doing there on her own? Well, people have argued, and I think that's probably true, that because she was ashamed, the other women, probably didn't like her, because as we're going to see in a minute, she was sexually immoral. But this woman, coming on her own, kind of an outcast, she gets a surprise. Because in verse 9, she says, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask me for a drink, which I'm a woman of Samaria? And then John explains, for the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. In fact, the Jews had destroyed about 100 years ago the temple, and they were talking by the well under a mountain called Mount Gerizim, and that had a temple on it. And in 128 BC, that was destroyed by the Jews, so that the relations were not only unfriendly, they were actually violent. And it's very surprising that Jesus would ask a Samaritan woman for a drink, not just because he's a Jew and she's a Samaritan, he's a man and she's a woman, but because to take a drink from a Samaritan woman makes you unclean. So she's amazed, and Jesus' disciples are even more amazed when they come back at the end and they've discovered, verse 27, Jesus' followers come back and they meet Jesus talking to this Samaritan woman. They're shocked. What are you doing talking to her? Very, very strange thing to do. But Jesus crosses that barrier, and more than that, he offers her this wonderful living water. Jesus says, if you want a drink, I can give you a drink that's living water. That means you'll never need to drink again. And obviously the woman likes the sound of this. She wouldn't have to take a water pot on her head. And Jesus is giving her, offering her living water. Living water, which was why we read that passage in Isaiah. So God promised hundreds and hundreds of years before Jesus that he would come and he would pour out water onto the dry ground. Living water. Now again, this is a very hot country, and if you don't have water, don't have water here, everything dies. But if you don't have water in Israel, in Palestine, you'll be dead in a short time. So Jesus offers her living water, water for eternity. And that's exactly the same, friends, as he offers us. Jesus doesn't charge, by the way, it's free. You don't have to pay anything, you don't have to do anything, you just have to come and take and receive that same living water that he gave 2,000 years ago. Because the woman has this deep internal need for water. Water's the most basic thing in life, isn't it? You can live without food for a while. Some people fast or don't eat, but if you have no water, you'll die in a very, very short time. And Jesus offers her and offers us living water. I don't know if you remember a famous Italian actress called Sophia Loren. Any of you remember her?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, she said, in my life, there's an emptiness that is impossible to fill. And if we don't have God in our life, if we don't believe in Jesus, then we have this emptiness and this loneliness and this desire for something. And we all try, don't we, to fill our lives with all sorts of things. Different people try all sorts of different things. Some people like football. I like football. I like support a different team to Chelsea. Other people like money, don't they? Some people like TV. All sorts of people like different things. There's nothing wrong with supporting a football team. Nothing wrong with... Some people like food, don't they? They love to go to restaurants. That's not sinful, it's not wrong. But if we make that the centre of our lives, if that's what we try and pour everything into, if we're trying to get meaning and fulfilment from that, it will let us down. Only Jesus can fulfil and give us that living water, give us that relationship with God. And we can't by ourselves have a relationship with God because of the sin that's within us, because of all the different wrong things that we do. And this woman was a sinner. And friends, we're all sinners. I'm a sinner. Peter's a sinner. Everybody here is a sinner. We're all fall short every day, don't we, of God's glory. We all, if we try for 1 hour, maybe when we're asleep, we're okay, I don't know, although even then we can have strange thoughts. But certainly when we're awake, we can't even go for 1 hour without thinking something wrong or thinking something bad or doing something wrong. But the wonderful offer of the Lord Jesus here is living water. Living water also in the sense of cleaning us, because we're dirty by nature. We're sinful. We're aliens. We're enemies of God. And Jesus came, and through his death on the cross, living water pours out to each one of us. Now, you might think that there's something strange here, because after this exchange with the woman where she says, oh yeah, I like this water, Jesus says, whoever drinks of this water shall thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst. So fulfilling our deepest needs, our needs to be made right with God, but the water that I will give him will be in him a well of water springing up to everlasting life. So Jesus says to her, go call your husband and come back. And you might think it's a bit strange thing to say. Well, why does Jesus, it looks like Jesus is trying to change the subject. But actually, Jesus is putting his finger on one of the areas in her life that's wrong. One of the areas in her life that, if you like, needs cleaning through God's water. Because the woman answers and said, I have no husband. Jesus almost laughs there and says, yeah, that's quite right, actually. Yeah, no, you said correctly, because you've actually had five husbands and you're living with someone now and he's not your husband, which is probably why this lady wasn't very popular with the other women in this place in Samaria. So now the woman tries to change the subject, and you know, sometimes that's like us, when we feel Jesus is speaking to us, then somehow it can make us a little bit uncomfortable, so we start to change the subject. So she kind of, I don't know if any of you like cricket, but she kind of bowls him a theological googly, kind of difficult, very difficult question. So she says, well, where are we meant to worship then? And Jesus replies to her, verse 21, woman, which is not a rude thing, it's a polite way of saying woman, believe me, the hour comes when you are neither on this mountain, so the mountain here, Gerizim, where the Samaritans worship, nor in Jerusalem worship God. Now, as Jesus explains, the correct place to worship God was the temple, which was then standing. It was destroyed in AD 70 by the Romans. But what he's saying is the temple, that was the place in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew Bible, where God most of all lived. There was the Holy of Holies, which was the most sacred place. And only one day a year could one man, the high priest, go in on the Day of Atonement. And they used to put a rope around his leg in case he collapsed. And they had to haul him out because nobody else could go in there. So one place on earth, you had to be a male Jew to go into the central bit. And now Jesus is saying, I'm God. I'm God. I, Jesus, am the Messiah. And we don't need the temple anymore. The temple, in fact, is going to be destroyed. And now we must worship God in spirit and in truth. That's important, isn't it? We need both spirit and truth. In some churches we have a lot of spirit and not much truth. In some churches we have a lot of truth and not much spirit. We need both. And when we talk of the spirit, we also mean the Holy Spirit. We need God's help to worship him, because we can't do it by ourselves. And then there's an amazing thing. And you know, something that's really interesting is this is the only place in John's Gospel where Jesus is so open. Because the woman says, well, oh, this Messiah, this wonderful prophet is coming. And Jesus says, yeah, that's me. That's me. So the one place where he does it is to a woman, an outsider. Mm-hmm. She's not a Jew. He reveals himself to her. And friends, that's what he's trying to do this morning through my feeble explanation. Is he's trying to reveal himself to you and say, I am God. I am God. Believe in me. That's what being a Christian is about. It's not about being born in a Christian country. It's not about going to church, although it's good to do that, and most good to see you here. It's about trusting in the Lord Jesus and putting our life in him. And if we do that, we make a wonderful exchange. I don't know if any of you like to buy and sell stuff on eBay. You know, you go and someone offers something, you buy it. Well, Jesus says you don't have to pay anything. You can come with all the rubbish and all the things that are wrong in your life, all the pain and suffering. We've all done things, haven't we, that are wrong and we feel sad about, and in return I will give you eternal life. And the expression that Jesus uses in verse 26 in Greek, we won't have too much Greek, but we'll have one Greek thing in the Greek text, it's ego eimi, I am. Jesus literally says, I am. Now this is a very important word for two reasons. One is that in John, Jesus seven times says, I am something. So he says, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And I am the vine. But I am also has another meaning, because the name of God in the Old Testament, Yahweh or Jehovah, which is a very holy name that Jews even now will not say, is in English, you say, I am that I am. So Jesus is saying, I am God. And the woman's response is interesting, isn't it? Verse 28, the woman left her water pot, went away into the city, and says to the men, come, see a man who's told me all things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ? So she's coming with her water pot. She's coming in the daily routine of life. She's not expecting anything particularly. She's probably feeling a bit sad and lonely, I would guess, and hot. And she has this encounter with Jesus, encounter with the living God, and everything changes. In fact, she's so excited about meeting Jesus She runs back to the city to get her friends and leaves the water pot there. Hopefully that's the same with us. There are things in life that we need to eat and drink. But the most important thing, friends, is to meet with the Lord Jesus. And if we do that, and if we believe on him and we trust in him, then he will transform our lives. And what's interesting here is the effect that this woman has on the people, because they all come out, pouring out of the city, and they all come and they meet with Jesus, and Jesus stays with there for 2 days, doesn't he? Verse 40. The Samaritans would come unto him, they asked him that he would stay with them, and he stayed with there 2 days. And many believed because of his word, and they said to the woman, "Now we believe, not because of what you said, but we've heard him ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Christ, the Messiah, the Saviour of the world." So just in summary, I'd like to make two concluding comments. First of all, I want to talk to those of you who are already followers of the Lord Jesus, who already are Christians, who already know the risen Lord. And I would like us to take Jesus' example of how we share our faith with our friends who haven't yet met him. So Jesus doesn't avoid his mission, does he? In fact, he says in verse 34, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work." So that's the same with us. God may lay on our hearts, friends, if we're believers, people that we should share with. Now, how do we share with them? There are many things we could do, but I think the best way is just to try and get people to read the Bible one-to-one. That's something I've been doing over the last couple of years. And there's a tremendous power and effectiveness in God's word. So if we have friends, maybe we can say to them, and there are notes available to do this, "Would you like to read the Bible with me?" I always like to make a joke of it. I say, you know, it's the world's best-selling book. There's probably something good in it. I also promise people, give me half an hour, and if you don't want to do it again, I'll never bother you again. So far, no one after half an hour has said no. So some people say, yes, I will read the Bible, others no. But there's a tremendous inherent power when we introduce people to Jesus. That's all we have to do. It's not about us. It's not about our ideas. It's about introducing our friends to him. And, you know, Jesus broke through all kinds of barriers, didn't he? This was the most unlikely person, friends, the most unlikely and indeed almost impossible person to bring anyone to faith. That's why Jesus' disciples are shocked. They're really quite horrified when they come back. "What are you doing talking to that woman?" But yet, because then she becomes a believer, she realizes that Jesus is the Messiah, the impact of what she has is enormous. The people in the town think, "My goodness, this woman actually, she of all people, maybe there is something in this." It's amazing, isn't it? God, we have little faith, but we serve a great God. Maybe God is laying on our heart the most unlikely person we can imagine, someone who we think, "Oh, they'll never become a Christian." Well, that would have been the Samaritan woman. So, friends, let's not lose faith. Let's come and introduce our friends to the most amazing person you ever met. What about, though, just finally, if you're not a Christian, if you've never come to faith in him? Well, friends, this woman had a surprise, didn't she? She came with her water pot. She came walking along, and there, sitting by the well, was this man. She didn't expect to meet. But Jesus expected to meet her. So Jesus has an appointment with that woman, and he has an appointment with you today. You're here and you can hear about Jesus. Jesus is seeking for us. He came to seek and save the lost. And he speaks to you. 2,000 years ago, through his word, he speaks to you now. And he offers you that living water, that fulfillment of all the deep needs we have, especially the need to be put right with God. Because by nature, we're far from God. We're sinners. We're enemies of God. And Jesus says, "Come and be reconciled to God." You can bring your doubts and questions and burdens along. This woman, by the way, didn't get it all right, did she? She didn't run back with the 5 points of Calvinism. She didn't run back with William Perkins. No. She said, could this be the Christ? So she's changing, but that change process can take a while. And if you've got questions or things you wonder about, you know, is God really there? Is Jesus really God? Bring them with you. Come as you are. don't need to reform, you don't need to get all your theology and ideas of God right. No, come as you are. Get to know him. Why? Because he loves you. And because he died for you. Because, you know, and this is my final word, think of the scene. This is the heat of the day. This is noon. Sun's beating down. And Jesus says, I'm thirsty. Well, a few years later, it was the same scene, but not by a well, on a cross. The heat of the day, the sun's beating down, Jesus is nailed to a cross. Why? Because he loves us. Because he came to make us right with God. And he says the same thing, I thirst. Jesus experienced thirst that he might fulfill our thirst to be made right with God. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for the wonderful story of this Samaritan lady and how she had a surprise meeting with your dear son, the Messiah, the Christ, and came to faith in him. We pray that if we are followers of yours, we would be bold and courageous and share and introduce our friends and family to the risen Lord. We thank you especially for any friends that are here this morning who have not yet come to put their trust in the Lord. We pray that they would, and that they would go away rejoicing and full of the living water that your Son wonderfully offers us, free, without condition, to receive from him eternal life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.